Welcome back for round one. Let's see how our almost standard, not even close, red-white beatdown deck does in this Kaladesh draft. Looks like we have a pretty good hand here, as we're going to have a 3-2 attacking on turn two. Hopefully the opponent has a slow draw. Since we are on the draw first, it's likely they could just play a 2-2 or something on turn two and stop it right away. But if they do have a slow draw, then this hand could definitely run somebody over. These first couple turns are pretty scripted, as we have exactly one 1-mana card, exactly one 2-mana card, and exactly one 3-mana card in our hands. Can't really imagine too interesting of a decision, since we have no decisions. I can't even imagine there's very many 3-mana cards we're going to draw that we're going to cast over Dipala next turn. And that's convenient, because the opponent's going to make it a 1-4, thinking it will stop our 3-2, but now we're going to give Dwarves +1/+1. Dipala is awesome. Doesn't pump servos, though, just dwarves and vehicles. So the 1-1's still going to stay home, but we will get to attack for 4 here again on turn 3. Our hand's a little thin, though, and flooding out it makes it really hard to win with decks like this. That's why I almost always run 16 land in them. I think it's almost always a mistake to run 17 in these aggro decks. I would rather just not play expensive cards. If you can even get to 15, I've done it a couple times. Clearly not with this deck. We have like 4 mana cards. But I've had some aggro decks in this format where I've played 15 land where I had like 2 4-mana cards and all cards that cost like 2 and 3. Here, though, this is going to be a tough game for us to win despite our rares because, you know, we have 7 land and 4 spells. So we have to decide what we want to do here. Inspiring Charge could allow us to make an attack. If the opponent realizes what we're up to and puts the Pima Outrider in front of the Servo, if we attack with all three, and the High Spire Artisan in front of the Dipala, we'll lose the Servo, but we'll eat the Artisan, and we'll deal 6, but we'll be out our charge. What I'm doing right now is thinking about the opponent's potential blocks, because I'm trying to decide what to attack with. If we send just the Toolcraft, it's not a bad trade for the Pima Outrider, but we don't want to be trading. We really, when you have Inspire Charge, you know, trade-offs are pretty bad. If the opponent blocks the Pima Outrider, the Dipala with the Pima Outrider, and the High Spire Artisan with the Servo, which is probably their most likely block if we attack with all three, that's pretty bad for us, because we're forced to use the charge, and we still lose the Dipala, and we can't even spend the mana to pump the Dipala, to use the Dipala's ability. Granted, well, we don't have that many dwarves, but we have maybe a few. I think the Motorist is a dwarf, and we have the 6-1 vehicle. So definitely with all these lands, I don't think I want to suicide Dipala. I think that we want to wait until we can just make an attack where we pay for it. If we got a third artifact, the Toolcraft would be able to attack with First Strike. So maybe we don't attack with anything, or maybe we offer this Toolcraft for the Pima Outrider. I think that's really our only choice. I don't think Inspired Charge is going to work out well for us this turn. I think if we attack with the Toolcraft and they don't block, we'll be really happy. I think if they block with the Pima Outrider, which is somewhat likely, we'll kind of regret it, but it's not that bad a trade for us. By the time we draw a third artifact, they likely would have a double block that would work anyway. Plus, if we clear the Outrider and they don't have follow-up, then the Dipala could attack and we could pay 5. So I think it's right to attack with the Toolcraft. They'll probably trade, play something else, and we'll probably slightly regret it. But I think if they don't have any follow-up, then they have to take the 4, or the trade is really good for us. So I think the correct attack on this turn is just Toolcraft Exemplar. Okay, and they took it, so glad we got in that 4 damage. That could easily end up winning us the game with the Inspire Charge later. It's also a good sign, because it probably means the opponent doesn't have that much strong follow-up. As we see, they're just playing a 2-1 here. So we'll. I guess I didn't have a stop on there for end of turn, or I must have passed priority through their turn. Okay, no big deal. Sorry about the mistake, but we wouldn't be alphing anyway here, I don't think. We're just going to make the same attack here. So, not sure what I did there. I didn't even think I clicked a button, but welcome to Magic Online, I guess. And it was probably my fault. So if they go for the double block here, if they don't have anything, we're going to kill both and our creature is going to live. So this is really good. If they do have some, like impeccable timing or something, I'm going to get completely blown out here. But I don't really have a ton of reason to put them on that. It's not a card that people always play with, and it looks like they might be splashing white. So we're going to go ahead and play the Inspire Charge here. go for the blowout. Well, that didn't work as planned. I guess I ordered the creatures wrong because of the ornamental courage. Speaking of blowouts, that was really bad for me. Probably should have played around that, because that is a card people play, unlike Impeccable Timing, so that turn was pretty bad. Wow, and now they're dying the Dipala, huh? Well, this game went downhill fast. Granted, I don't think that we were going to win this game if we did things better. If I sacked the Puzzlement in a turn like I mean to and would have, you know, in person or what have you, I still wouldn't have, like, attacked with everything there or anything. So, because I can't pay for the Dipala because I need to leave the Inspire Charge up, and the Inspire Charge is not anywhere near good enough yet. So I think this game is going to be pretty rough for us no matter what we do. And I mean, when you draw 8 lands with, you know, what's supposed to be a cheap aggro deck, it just is what it is sometimes. So, we will have to hope for a better draw, next game, I think. I mean, we're not completely out of it if we really draw great and the opponent doesn't have anything, but, this game is looking rough, of course. And that Inspired Charge turn was just too bad for me. With the opponent at 9, I don't know if there's any shot if we, like, say, don't attack that turn or something. If we're able to go on to win this game with an Inspired Charge here, the answer is probably not. But nonetheless, that attack was bad. And if nothing else, I should have put the 2-1 first, since I knew I was going to play the Inspired Charge. Ordering it that way just subjected me to a bigger blowout than necessary. At least the Sage would have died had I done it the better way. So that was just a mistake. Even if attack and charge is correct there, which it likely is, the Sage should be ordered first in case they have +1/+3. Ornamental Courage. Okay. Anyways, definitely don't feel like it cost us this game, though, so that's nice. Now we're going to go for the triple block, I think. That's one of the main drawbacks of aggro decks, why you have to play such low land counts, especially Inspired Charge aggro decks. You can't really win if you're flooded. When your deck involves, like, the synergy and combo between Inspired Charge attacking with everything plus having a lot of creatures, if you draw too many lands, you just can't assemble that. That said, I think this deck is good, and I think this archetype is good. You know, limited decks almost always have flaws. You just can't get everything you want out of every deck. Okay, let's see if we can draw anything here. Okay, I definitely don't mind showing these cards. It doesn't matter. And the Motorist is a dwarf. The Motorist is a really nice card. Getting the Scry 2 out of your 2-drop just really smooths your draws and is excellent. While I'd like to find stuff more powerful than Apprentice, it is a 2-3. I think that's going to have to be good enough to leave on top. The Responder definitely going on top first. So the opponent only has those two creatures, the Aetherborn and the Gearsmith, that can get through the Responder. But they did also buy back their dead Pima Outrider, so that's another creature that's a very real threat for us. So now we definitely have to make this trade. Hopefully, if they're holding nothing else, then potentially they're only... Well, they're going to attack with the Gearsmith and the Outrider this turn. So, yeah, we're in really bad shape. I'm not even sure I want to show this Responder. If they attacked with everything, and I might be able to block the Sage, and then that would be okay. So I'll play it because it's just a creature anyway. I don't think it's really going to change that much for the opponent. But if they make the attack they should here with Pima Outrider and Gear Hulk, even if they don't have anything, I can't take the 7. So I'm then forced to chump with the Servo. Knowing I'm drawing Inventor's Apprentice, I don't really see a way out of this. Or I can double block the Gearsmith, but that doesn't seem great. Probably chump with the Servo for now. And then my Inventor's Apprentice is just going to be a 1-2. Yeah, I'm out of this game. Let's just see what else the opponent has. Plus, even though it's unlikely to have a creature deck, they don't know that we don't have a Fumigate. So if you concede too early in games like this, you kind of tell the opponent you don't have outs, and Fumigate could certainly allow you to come back in a game like this. So that's another problem with conceding too early. But Wildest Dreams. Okay, but now I'm just going to concede because I'm dead on board if I don't have anything, and so it doesn't really give away much or anything. Okay, so let's see. We didn't really see stuff to fragmentize. They mostly just played real creatures. Inspired Charge could potentially be good against their deck. It looked pretty slow and full of big creatures. Acrobatic Maneuver didn't seem great. Yeah, I don't think we're going to make any changes. Maybe Renegade Tactics would actually be pretty good against them. I kind of feel like if we bring that in, though, we'd kind of have to take out a land. I really don't want to flood out. And I mean, while I do think you can go to 15, especially when you're bringing in a 1-mana card that draws a card, I don't know if you can do it with 6/4 drops. I think that would be bad. So, and I can't take out the artifacts because I need those. So it would have to be an Inspired Charge for Renegade Tactics, which I don't think is right. So let's just go to game two and not mess up our deck by oversideboarding, by trying to do something when there isn't anything good to do. Okay, this is a pretty good hand. Definitely like this hand. We can get down a 3-power creature on turn 2 here. Not as good as having on turn 1 last game, but last game we were on the draw and kind of flooded out. This game, hopefully we can use this Motorist to find a Plains, and then we'll be pretty good. Okay, I'm not going to take either of those since we really need a Plains. So bottom. It would have been interesting if we saw a Mountain. I think I would have bottomed the Mountain, even though we have all these 4-mana cards, because I can cast the Servo Expedition off just the 2 lands, and I really need a white to cast Aerial Responder, but a Plains is definitely the card we were looking for there. So Cub is really scary. As I mentioned during the draft, I call it a Mythic Uncommon in that it has the power level of a Mythic Rare. It might not look like it, but that's because it only costs 2 mana. What you get for 2 mana at a Cub is just incredible. For example, normally I would attack with the Motorist here and then play the Responder, but the opponent could play an energy creature and then I wouldn't be able to block the Cub. Now granted, maybe I can race it given what my deck does, but let's think about it. Let's try and think it through a little bit. The opponent will go to 17, they'll hit me back. They'll have the energy creature to block the Motorist. They'll only be taking 2 and the Cub will be growing. I don't think that's a good exchange. I think I'd rather leave the Motorist back to try and block the Cub. And, you know, that's no big deal, but that shows you the power of the Cub right here, in that I'm not even attacking with my aggro deck on turn 2 out of respect for the opponent's 2-drop. So, yeah, Cub is incredibly powerful. It can single-handedly take over a game very easily. But I've got good stuff going, too. You know, this game, it's going to be hard for me to flood out as I have no more lands in hand, and as long as I don't draw too many more 4-drops. Basically, if I draw 1 land, I can cast my whole hand. If I don't, then I'm drawing spells I can cast. So what's the opponent going to do? They can play Subtle Strike, which, if I block with the Motorist, will not really own me in any way, because they could kill the Motorist with it anyway. They could play +1/+0 on Lifelink, which definitely doesn't make me want to block the Responder, just Motorist. I mean, I won't be happy if they have that, but what are you going to do? They could play Ornamental Coverage, which kind of makes me want to double block, but then they could just, if they didn't play it, they could just trade with the Motorist, the same as if I single blocked it. If they did play it, they could trade with the Responder, but they wouldn't get both of my creatures, and they would lose the Cub anyway. So maybe, since I would happily trade this Motorist for their Cub, because Cub is just too scary in my opinion, maybe double block is better than single block. If they have Blossoming Defenses, they'll kill both. That's pretty bad for me. And I do have ground creatures to block with next turn potentially, so I think we'll block with just Motorist. If they have Ornamental Courage, the card we saw last game, I guess I might slightly regret not double blocking. But as long as, you know, I'm hitting in the air, I'm draining for two, and I'm staving off the Cub growing till later, it's not the end of the world if the Cub ends up getting going. So this is an interesting spot, whether you block with just Motorist or double block. I would never take it here and let the Cub get going on its own. I actually forgot they had the two energy from Attune there. Sorry. So if I double blocked and they had the Courage, they would live and take out both. So that play would be absolutely terrible. Let's reevaluate. I just happened to check their energy supply and see that they have two. So of course block with just Motorist makes sense. They can't blow me out, really. As far as if they Courage, then they Courage and the Cub lives. They spend the energy and Courage, or they don't spend the energy. They just Courage and the Cub lives. No big deal. Plus one, plus O doesn't change anything. Subtle Strike doesn't really change anything. Okay, so yeah, a double block would be bad because they could spend the two energy to get the three toughness and then play Ornamental Courage and get to six, and then we wouldn't even be able to kill the Cub. Meanwhile, we would lose both creatures because they would have four power and not three. So this is just a very clear block now with just Motorist. Let them play the Ornamental Courage, no big deal, and the Cub doesn't get going yet. And we'll hopefully be attacking them in the air with our aerial responder. Well, okay, that's off the table, but on the bright side, they're down in energy. So now we have a choice. Now we can play Servo Expedition or Revoke Privileges. Cub is scary, but at the moment, Servo Expedition would be stopping it unless they play an Energy Maker or unless they play like a trick. I don't really want to lose the creatures with the double Inspire Charge hand. But at the same time, I would trade them both for Cub, and I still have the Augmenter to make three creatures. And if they do play something like an Energy Maker so that I can't block the Cub, then I can go ahead and revoke the Cub later. So I think it's probably correct to play Servo Expedition here. We'll leave up the white since you can't play Built to Smash except when you're attacking, but you can play Built to Last anytime. And I will double block if the opponent attacks. If they have a trick, they can take out the two servos. It's not the end of the world. If they play an energy creature pre-combat, then we can't block. But that's okay. Then we'll go ahead and end up revoking the Cub. It's not like we have to chump block or something like that. We'll preserve our creatures. If we draw the land this turn, I'll probably drop the Augmenter. If we don't, I would drop the Revoke on the Cub, but for now I'll take the one more hit from the Cub. As long as the opponent doesn't have a Make Obsolete, then we should have a decent chance this game. We're going pretty wide with double Inspired Charge in hand, and we have Revoke for either Cub if they keep investing in it, or a good blocker if they drop one. If they make Obsolete, then of course we're completely dead, and that's just not fair or fun. Okay, and the opponent pumped the Cub so that the Fairgrounds Trumpeter would get pumped also, but respecting the fact that we might have an Alpha and an Inspire Charge or something, decided not to attack. So if we Alpha, so our only choice is this turn, basically. If we were to revoke the Cub, then the Trumpeter would still effectively stop our attack. So that play doesn't make a ton of sense. If we turn everybody, the opponent can block the Cub on the Augmenter, but if the Trumpeter blocks, we'll take it out with Charge and deal a lot of damage. But considering we can put two more creatures in play and one of them flies, I think casting Propeller Pioneer here is a pretty clear play. We've already established that we have no shot against Make Obsolete, so now we're going to play the rest of this game like that's not a card that exists. Other than that, we have a decent shot because we now have seven creatures in play, and a removal and two Inspire Charges. That's the thing about Inspire Charge. You lose creatures generally when you attack and charge, so a second charge isn't nearly effective as the first. So you really want exactly one of it, which is why you don't necessarily want a ton of it in your deck. But at the same time, decks can kind of go all in on going very wide, something our deck is only medium at. And then you would, you know, drawing Inspired Charge is crucial. Also, you may have enough creatures left post Inspired Charge. So as long as we don't die on the swing back now, I think an attack and a charge is going to be pretty good for us. We could even, if we're worried about that, just revoke the cub and swing out, since Servos versus Sage Inspired Charge doesn't really do anything. If we attack, let's look at our options for this turn. If we revoke the cub and we send all seven creatures, the opponent can eat the augmenter with their Fairgrounds Trumpeter and trade off the two sages for 2/1/1s. If they don't, I think that's favorable for us because it gets in damage and those servos are valuable later with the charges anyway. If they do, then the end result here is the opponent takes 3 damage from the 3 unblocked servos and 2 damage from the Pioneer. And basically, the 2 damage from the Pioneer is going to happen no matter what we do this turn, so we don't really have to factor that in that much. So we'd be sacrificing Visionary Augmenter to deal 3 damage, basically. So that probably isn't worth it. If we attack and then we charge the 3 and we don't play the Revoke, then the opponent's going to block the Cub on the Augmenter and a Servo with the Fairgrounds Trumpeter, and our charge isn't really going to help us. 2 Servos will get through on the Pioneer, so that means we'd be looking at dealing 10 damage to the opponent, which is not 18. So I think in this instance, there's not a lot for us to accomplish by attacking. I think this turn is probably just going to be revoke the opponent's cub, their biggest creature, and attack with the Pioneer. We're definitely not worried about saving the revoke for a flyer, because if the opponent plays a flyer, we will just be attacking and charging. So I think this is a pretty clear turn. Certainly, now that we're not adding creatures to the board, we are going to have to just push and use our charge, and hopefully it's enough. But we were able to take out a creature, so if the opponent plays one creature, then this play was better for us than charging the previous turn, most likely. If the opponent plays like Pima Outrider and makes a 1-1, it could work out a little worse for us, but really the 1-1's going to block a servo, we're going to miss some damage, but we're going to eat the 1-1 when we cast charge. So I think it's unlikely that this play really works out poorly for us, as opposed to attacking and charging. And once again, I mean, if they have Make Obsolete or something, we can't win, so that's not really a consideration. And now that they didn't add to the board, I think this will be a good turn. Now we're just definitely going to attack with everything in charge. And if the opponent blocks the Trumpeter on the Augmenter, then we'll be able to take it out. They shouldn't do that. They should just put the Sage on the Augmenter, since Inspire Charge isn't going to let the Augmenter live anyway. And the Fairgrounds Trumpeter can block one servo, and then the Sage can block another servo. But we're still going to deal them a lot of damage, and they're only going to be left with just the Trumpeter in play. And they did. They made the exact best block they could make here, which is Sage blocks a servo, Sage blocks the Augmenter, and that's what it's called, right? Yeah, and Fairgrounds Trumpeter blocks a servo. But the thing is, we have so many creatures at this point that now 4 creatures are getting through, and even though it's not 16, it's like 13 damage, and they're going to be left with 1 creature, so still a good turn for us. So unfortunately, the charge wasn't really able to push any of our creatures past any of theirs because the opponent's creatures are so big. But, you know, it dealt 8 damage, which is about all you can ask for out of an aggro deck. And I don't know why they conceded, given if they die young, the Pioneer, our 3 servos to their 1 Trumpeter would not be lethaling them. Even if we don't have, as long as we don't have anything else, then they could block 1 and go to 1, and we'd have 2 creatures to their 1, and then they could untap and just play a creature next turn and be stable. That's not how it would have played out, you know, but I mean, they don't know that. So that was a little bit of a premature concession, I think, but we were going to win that game since we had second charge, so no big deal. Okay. So we've seen Dai Young and Ornamental Courage as far as tricks. So Acrobatic Maneuver is not really the best against those. Impeccable Timing does seem reasonably good. I mean, I'm really scared of a turn 2 Cub. I guess we could try and have Fireweaver in as another way to block it. We could have Impeccable Timing in to try and hit it, but if they have the Courage, that's pretty bad. And if we leave our mana up, they might not even attack. I mean, they probably will, but they might not. It's kind of a tough spot. I mean, the opponent has a green creature deck full of big, big creatures. I do feel like multiple charges is not the most effective against them, and dealing them some damage without attacking plus having a blocker for Cub is good. So I think I'm going to take out a charge for a Reckless Fireweaver here. I don't think this play is great, but I think it's probably correct. I think that if they play Cub and we play Fireweaver and they don't have anything, that could easily win us a game. And I think drawing double charge is pretty bad against them since they're a big creature deck. Can't really imagine anything else we could do. We could take out Red Puzzle Knot. I don't know if we saw any one toughness creatures, really. We saw some Servo Makers. But I kind of feel like we don't have a ton of artifacts. So I'm not that comfortable with going lower on artifacts. We really didn't see anything to Fragmentize. Fragmentize can be a really tempo-positive card. You know, you can kill a 3 or 4 mana card for 1 mana, but I don't think we really saw artifacts out of them. Yeah, I think I'm going to do just that and submit. Could consider going down one more land since we're on the draw for the 1 mana creature can't block since we took out a 4-drop too. But going to 15 is probably greedy. Okay, definitely going to keep this. Don't have any white, but we have 9 white sources in the deck. Hopefully we'll draw them. And in the meantime, we have some stuff to do. It's not that bad a hand. Oh yeah, I forgot the opponent had to double Sage, so taking out the Fireforge Puzzle Knot would have been bad. Sage is such a bad card that it barely registers in my head, but yeah, it is a good card to take out with a Puzzle Knot, since we just want an artifact to stick in play for a lot of our cards, and we don't want to play Puzzle Knot just to deal 1 to the opponent. So this is a pretty good exchange for us. The opponent will almost certainly leave the Sage back to try and block the Grubs, but we'll be able to Puzzle Knot away the Sage and grow the Grubs here to a 3-2, deal the opponent 3. Hopefully we'll draw a Plains or a land, but if we don't draw one this turn, it's not that big of a deal. I mean, we're not going to win this game if we're stuck on 2 forever, but also this is a good enough turn 3 that not having the land right now is not a huge deal. So, and the opponent die younging our 3-2 is actually a pretty good sign for us, because if they had any good creatures to drop, they would probably have just dropped them. The fact that they're using a removal spell on our 2-drop there on turn 4 means their hand probably doesn't have any 3 or 4 mana creatures that they could have played. They could have the Gearsmith we saw in game 1, since we know they probably don't want to Gearsmith a Sage. That's a card that could easily be in their hand. Alright, we have other artifacts to play, so we're going to go ahead and sack this Puzzle Knot, take out the 1 toughness creature. Our Vantage is a nice white source, but not this turn since it's going to come into play tapped. So that lets us use all our mana, deal the most damage we can do, and use our Puzzle Knot effectively. Okay, and they're using another Die Young on another creature. So I assume they're really not holding any creatures. Looks like we can't cast our double white cards yet, so this turn our options are going to be Motorist and White Puzzle Box, or like, I don't know, play Torch Gauntlet. No reason to do that, so go ahead and use Motorist. We'll keep a Plains, but we'll bin any Mountain since we don't need that. We're definitely going to keep the Plains because we have 2 good double white cards, but the Servo Expedition is interesting. I think at this point we're in a pretty favorable position. Anything is probably better than a land. So I think we should probably just keep the Servo Expedition. I think we'll put the Plains on top. And then next turn we can have 5 mana, double white, cast Responder and Torch Gauntlet or Pyro Helix and Responder, depending on what the opponent does, or even just Augmenter. We'll just see what the opponent does, of course. But I think we should draw the Servo Expedition the turn after this, which, you know, is a somewhat close call. Okay, so now We can't attack with the motorist right now because they'll just throw a servo in front of it. We can attack with it with a torch gauntlet after we clear those servos out of the way with pyro helix. And aerial responder is going to be pretty threatening, and the opponent only has one card left in hand. So I think this turn is... There's no reason to spend our Chandra's Pyro Helix now. We can just do it later. Those 1-1s sitting in play are not scary. So I think we want to cast our responder and put our Torch Gauntlet out. Even though sometimes it's nice to play Torch Gauntlet and use it, equip it the turn you play it as kind of a surprise, I don't think it's that relevant now that the opponent has one card in hand. We could have passed and Pyro Helixed end a turn and then played Torch Gauntlet and used it, but we might draw... Well, we know we're drawing Servo Expedition, so I guess I could have planned that out a little more, but I'm not even sure we're going to end up Pyro Helixing those servos. I definitely want to see what the opponent's going to do. They keep tapping all this mana. That is kind of scary. I don't know what costs 7. There's the 5/7 that makes another servo when it comes into play. If they do that, we'll... Oh, Wildest Dreams, right. We had previously seen that. So they got back 3 cards there, 2 Die Youngs and 1 of the Sages. So we know we're not going to be able to win in the air anymore. So now we have a choice. We could Pyro Helix away the 2 servos and put the Torch Gauntlet on the motorist, which means they have to take the hard hit for 5 and the 2 in the air for 7 down to 6 life, or they trade away the Edgecrafters for the motorist, which would be pretty good for us. Or we could put the Torch Gauntlet on the responder. We get in 4 damage instead of 7, and then we can develop our board with the Servo Expedition. Or we could just hit them for 2 in the air with the responder and play the Augmenter. So the question is really, what kind of an attack are we going to have next turn? We know that they're going to probably play a Die Young or 2 and a Sage. They have 4 cards in hand. They just bought back those 3, 2 Die Youngs and 1 Sage. So we know that our aerial responder is going to be killed. And they'll probably take out the veteran motorist also. So I feel like, you know, the only real downside to, in terms of making the play that does 7 this turn is that we're using the Pyro Helix on 2 servos when we know we can kill a Sage in a servo, which is better. But I don't think it's that different. But also, we have the potential to save the Pyro Helix to kill the Edgecrafters if it blocks, like, Augmenter as a 2-1 later or something like that. Plus, like, we will be able to torch Gauntlet up a lot of 1-1s, so that's 3 power. So using the Pyro Helix now means we can't necessarily remove Edgecrafters when we want to. So I think that play is actually wrong. I think the right play here is just going to be to play it slow and try and kind of grind the opponent out with our 1-1s. It's going to take a while because the opponent can always throw a servo in front of a 1-1. But we actually have a lot of 1-1s. We can make 2 1-1s with the Augmenter, 2 1-1s with the Servo Expedition, and another one with the Puzzle Knot. So I think the right play is to play it slow for now. So I'm just going to Torch Gauntlet the Aerial Responder, take the 4 damage and the 4 life. The opponent can't do anything about this, and cast the Servo Expedition. I'm not confident this play is right. I'm confident it's not wrong by a lot because the options, I think, are close in what they offer. I'll be happy if good players end up weighing in on this decision on this turn. So we knew that was going to happen since our aerial responder was our best creature by miles. What we don't know is whether they'll use the other Die Young on the motorist or save it for potential flyers. Okay, they've elected to save it. So what we know now is that if they... trading like servos off is good for us because the opponent's going to run out of creatures and then we'll be able to keep attacking. To our knowledge, they're holding 1 Die Young and the other card is probably nothing. It could be the Gearsmith. That's a pretty scary card for us, but what can you do? So I think if we Torch Gauntlet a servo and then attack with it, if they trade servos with us, yeah, that's what they're probably going to do. It's not very effective, but we need to try and get that to happen. If they block it with the Edgecrafters, then we can Pyro Helix 1 to the Edgecrafters and 1 to the Sage. And then if they don't have the way to recur the Edgecrafters, it's quite good for us. So this is the game we're going to play now, I think. And since we don't have an Inspire charge and we did board one out, there is only two in our deck. I'm not going to play sitting around hoping to draw one of those. Wow, that's a big cub. When we could press on board, and if the opponent didn't draw that cub, our plan would have worked of kind of trading off 1/1s until we were able to work through the Edgecrafter with the Pyro Helix. Now that they played the cub and they have a second creature with toughness, I'm not really sure what we're going to do. We're probably going to have to try and win with Inspired Charge. Given we have five creatures in play, Toolcraft Exemplar makes six and the Puzzle Knot makes seven, and we can use the Pyro Helix to clear a Servo and a Sage. That would put us up 7 creatures to 2, which means the opponent would die pretty handily if we drew Inspired Charge. So I'm going to, well, I don't know if I'm going to stop trading off 1/1s to try and get in, but I know that this turn I can't do it because that cub is effectively a 7/7. So this turn, there's nothing like that I can really accomplish. So I'm just going to go ahead and Torch Gauntlet up the big creature and play the Toolcraft. The reason I'm Torch Gauntleting the Augmenter and not the Servo is because it threatens to stop the Edgecrafter from attacking. Not that I think they're going to want to do that, but just in case. And if they want to attack with Cub, it's an extra power I can throw at the Cub. But I'm not going to block the Cub if they attack with it. If they attack with the Cub, I'm going to end up taking it, making a guy with the Puzzle Knot, untapping, and then Pyro Helixing away the 2/1 toughness creatures and alphaing. As long as they can't kill me in 2 hits with the Cub, that should be effective, which I don't think they can. Okay, so now we'll Puzzle Knot in case we draw Inspired Charge, though I don't know if I'll be attacking, trying to attack through 2 real creatures here. So with Cub's ability to eat Augmenter and Edgecrafter's eating Toolcraft Exemplar, they would take 5, and I'd be left with 5 creatures to their 2, which and they'd be at 4 life, which is not really lethal, and that's assuming they have nothing. So I really don't see that as a good play. A play that we can make is Torch Gauntlet on the Toolcraft Exemplar, since it'll have first strike and 5 power. They can only bring this Cub pumped 5 times to a 7/7, and they have to spend all their energy. So if they don't have a trick, I can make the Torch Gauntlet on Toolcraft attack. They block with Cub. They have to pump it to a 7/7, or a 6/6 anyway. I can deal at 5, and then I could finish it off with the Pyro Helix. Now, I think that play would be really good for me if they don't have a trick. But if they do have that Ornamental Courage, I will lose both cards, and the Cub will live and be giant. And then it'll be 6 creatures to 4 with the Pyro Helix gone, and I won't be able to win with one of my 2 Inspired Charges. So there is a pretty big drawback to doing that. On the other hand, if they don't have Ornamental Courage or some other removal or trick, it'll be pretty good because then next turn the Toolcraft Exemplar can attack again as a 5/2 first strike, and there's nothing they can really do about that. So it's a pretty tough call. I don't think it makes sense to play around a card like that in this spot since we don't know that it's in the opponent's hand. I think we would just be helping them putting a card in their hand. I have no real reason to believe they have anything. So I think, and we haven't even drawn that many lands, so we have a lot of potential to flood out from here. So I think it's the right play to press on board, but this is very likely not going to end up working and going to end up blowing up in our face. So, don't make fun of me too bad, but, I do think this is the right play. I don't think I want to put that card in my opponent's hand for no reason. You know, it's not like they've been telegraphing it. It's not like they've been making plays, you know, by telegraphing it, I mean making plays that make me think it's in their hand. Their hand could be 2 lands. Their hand could be a Gearsmith and a land. Their hand could be an Ornamental Courage and a Gearsmith. I mean, there's no way for me to really know what's in their hand. What the opponent does know now is that I have something, because of course I'm not sending this Toolcraft Exemplar in to just, you know, suicide it, because the Cub can be a 7/7. So the opponent has to decide what to do with the knowledge that I have something in my hand, something to push it past the Cub. And so the opponent has chosen to block with the Edgecrafter and the Cub. This way they can take care of this Exemplar even if I have something like a Pyro Helix. As a result, I think I get a good trade with the Edgecrafter for the Exemplar, but I can no longer make the play I wanted to make where I just eat the Cub. If I put the Cub first and I deal the 5 and the 2 to it, the Exemplar. I can take out the Cub, which is a bigger and scarier creature than the Exemplar, but the Exemplar will still finish off... the Edgecrafters will still finish off my Exemplar. If I put the Edgecrafters first, I can first strike it out and then just let the Cub eat my Exemplar. Now, Edgecrafters for Exemplar is a good trade for me, and I don't think I want to spend the Pyrohelix just to kill the Cub instead of the Edgecrafters. So I think we'll just go ahead and first strike out the Edgecrafters, assuming they don't have anything. Definitely a lot going on here. And that was a good block by the opponent, not just trying to eat it with the Cub, but recognizing that I must have something in order to make this play. And if Cub was a mere mortal 2-2, I would now deal 1 to it and 1 to the Sage. But of course, it's a 2-mana 7-7, so the opponent would just pay 2 energy and pump it, and that wouldn't work. If I dealt 2 to the Cub, they'd just pay 4 energy and pump it twice, so that wouldn't work. So now they can take out my my Exemplar. So assuming they don't have a way to regrow the Edgecrafters, then that was still favorable for us. Assuming they do, then it probably wasn't. But if they just pass the turn back here, it's going to be really good for us because we can Pyrohelix away the 2-1 toughness creatures, suit up Servo with Torch Gauntlet, and Alpha with everything. And we should be able to successfully Alpha for the win if the opponent's not holding anything. The fact that they dropped a creature makes it less good, but it's still pretty good for us. So we're still going to do it for sure. We'll just go 1-1 and take out the 2/2 ones. Hopefully we can draw Inspire Charge, but even if we don't, and that's not a terrible draw either because it's going to start growing. I don't think this matters much, but of course, since the Servo can block the Augmenter anyway, we want to put the Torch Gauntlet on one of the Servos and not the Augmenter. And we're going to go ahead and attack with everything. Now we're only sacrificing one creature. I don't really care about Augmenter for Servo. In fact, like, that trade is fine. So basically, we're eating one creature to deal 4 damage, which is clearly right with the opponent at 9. Not necessarily going to win us the game. If the opponent draws Gearsmith or a High Spire Artisan or Pima Outrider or something, the opponent could definitely stabilize this game. But we have to make them draw it, you know. Got to play to win. And we don't need the Bridge Patrol to be even bigger because it's still not going to be big enough to take out the Cub. So, of course, the Torch Gauntlet needs to go on a Servo, and then it's just attack with everything. Hopefully they don't have anything, and they're just dead. Cool. We won round one. See you back for round two.